Hello, I would like to welcome everyone to today's Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative webinar. My name is Susanna Swallow with the USGS Northern Rocky Mountain Science Center, and I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. A few housekeeping issues. There is no VoIP audio capability. All participants are muted, so if you do have questions, we ask that you please use the questions tool on GoToWebinar. And if they're questions specific to the presentation, I will read those to our presenter at the end of the talk, and then she'll be able to answer those questions from you. I would like to introduce our speaker today. It's Ann Kennedy. She's with the USDA ARS, and she's going to be talking about soil bacteria and weed management, cheating the cheatgrass, and Medusa Head. So at this time, Anne, if you would like to go ahead, I'm going to hand the baton over to you.
Okay. All righty. Well, I'll get started then. Thanks, Susanna. And I'd like to thank Sean Finn for suggesting that I give a talk in this format to you folks. So as Susanna said, I work for the USDA Agriculture Research Service, and I'm actually a soil scientist slash soil microbiologist. We study the microbes in the soil for lots of different management practices. Today I'd like to talk about the soil bacteria that are in the soil that we could use for weed management. And I apologize for this subtitle, but we're talking about cheating the cheatgrass and kaputting the Medusa Head. I've been looking at the Medusa Head name for quite some time and trying to figure out something that we could do, but we want to get rid of the cheatgrass and we want to get rid of the Medusa Head using soil bacteria. The group that I work with is Tammy Stubbs, Jeremy Hansen, and Renee Schulteis. Jeremy and I are with the USDA Agriculture Research Service, and Tammy and Renee work for Washington State University. Renee actually is funded off of some funds from the Nature Conservancy that we have to do this work. Well, we're located at Washington State University in Pullman. So the first thing that I really want to do is to talk to people about the importance of the microorganisms in the soil. There is so much genetic potential in the soil that we're ignoring because it's just too vast for us, that we really need to focus in and look at what we can use in our soil. There's billions and billions of different microorganisms in the soil that we could use for our benefit. So basically, we stand on a gold mine every time we walk on any soil. The big thing I think people forget is that soil is alive, and we need to make sure that we know that life in the soil needs to be taken care of. Right now, we have all these different microorganisms in the soil, cycling all the nutrients that we need for whatever practice that we're involved in. My group actually is more involved in cropland than rangeland or native land, but still we have this potential in that soil to use a lot of the genetic material that's in there. We just have to search for it. Well, we all remember Humpty Dumpty and how Humpty Dumpty had his fall off the wall. And I remember watching a young girl looking at this nursery rhyme and realizing that she finally figured out that it was an egg, and the eggs are top-heavy or bottom-heavy, whatever, and that's why Humpty Dumpty fell. The same sort of thing with trying to understand the microbes in the soil. Well, we thought the Humpty Dumpty fell off the wall because he was clumsy and he was an egg. But no, really, it had a microbial reason for his demise off that wall. So let me tell you a little bit about how our work all started. I was a postdoc with Lloyd Elliott here in Pullman, and we were looking at the poor growth of winter wheat in the early spring. And if you notice, you can see some yellow stripes in that field of winter wheat. This was in March or April that we see this, and usually the wheat outgrow this phenomenon. But Lloyd wanted to see what was actually happening there. Now, if you talk to a plant pathologist, they'll say, oh, it's Pythium root rot or some of the other root rots that are causing that discoloration or that lack of growth. and that lack of and that chlorosis that we're seeing. If you talk to a soil fertility person, they'll say, well, it's probably nitrogen immobilization. Those poor plants aren't getting enough nitrogen. If you talk to a hydrologist, they'll say, oh, well, it's because it's a low-lying area and there's too much water there. Well, Lloyd thought differently, and so he set out to look at all the microbes that were on that soil. And he found that there were a high number of Pseudomonas bacteria on the roots. And if you look at the picture here, we see winter wheat. To your left, you see a control plant, and you see where we added the bacteria to the field. So we went out and isolated from these stunted plants thousands and thousands of bacteria, found the ones that inhibited wheat, and we put them back out in the field to show that, yes, indeed, these organisms could inhibit those wheat plants. And so we also looked and we saw that these bacteria were very selective against certain cultivars. So certain cultivars of wheat would be susceptible to this inhibition, but others would not. We were working with wheat, but a lot of the barleys didn't show any negative effect by having the bacteria growing on their roots. So there was some selectivity there that we were looking at. And so we did an awful lot of work killing an awful lot of wheat plants with these bacteria, and I got kind of tired of that and started to ask, well, what about grass weeds? Could we use these selective inhibitory bacteria that we find in the early spring in soil to help us with weed control? So we first looked at cheatgrass, jointigo grass, and wild oat, and then Medusa head came later. Now, I'm sure with the audience out there, you folks know more about cheatgrass and Medusa head than I ever really hoped to, but let's just go through a few things that we can see, or the few of the properties or characteristics of cheatgrass. A lot of times I'll call it downy brome, but we're talking about Bromus tectorum. Okay. So it's an invasive weed, and really, ecologically speaking, it's a very serious invasive weed. It's a very competitive plant. It reduces crop yield in cereals sometimes by 10 or 15%. And sometimes it can actually totally devastate the cereal crop. It chokes out the natives in rangeland systems. And so we have huge infestations in rangeland and in native sites. It's a very high fire hazard due to its method of growth. And it's very low nutrition. It germinates in the fall and the spring. And it's very competitive with all these other plants because of its low temperature root growth. From the standpoint of a weed in wheat, cheatgrass can put on root growth faster in the spring and further into the fall, into the winter, than can the winter wheat. And so it's still growing and putting on root growth in those colder temperatures. It produces a lot of tillers and seeds, and we know that it's a very plastic plant. Given a little bit of shade, it'll still it'll grow and still produce seed. But given plenty of sun, it just goes gangbusters. So we're talking about a very plastic plant here. Medusa head is exactly the same. And actually, the reason we picked up Medusa head as a weed to look at is that folks were saying, well, sometimes cheatgrass is my only protein source, and so I don't want Medusa head to come in because it's even worse. But Medusa head, again, like cheatgrass, is an invasive weed. It's a very competitive plant. It chokes out the natives and beneficial plants. I haven't seen it too much in cropland, but certainly in rangeland, it's infesting large acreage. It's a very high fire hazard, and it's got very low nutrition. It germinates in the fall and the spring, and it's competitive due to this low temperature root growth that it puts on. It produces many tillers and seed, and it has this thatch-like residue, and it does take up silica, so it's kind of a little bit different from the cheatgrass. But still, those are the two weeds that we'll be looking at today. So one of the things we do is we go out and look at different isolates in the soil. Most of the time, we're looking at it from a more of a molecular standpoint. But for these plants or these bacteria that we're talking about, we do this screening that we isolate the soil and root bacteria after a freeze-thaw. So that means that we actually have to go out in late February, early March with gloves and double surgical gloves on to stay, for us to stay warm, because this is the time where these inhibitory bacteria like to grow. They really like that thaw that's right after a freeze. So we've gone out and collected, for this study, 10,000 different bacteria we did start with. So let's just set that at 100%. So we bioassay the weeds, and here you can see the petri dishes. On the left side is the control, and you can see plenty of root growth. And where we had applied the bacteria to the surface of the water auger, you just see the bacteria with lacking root growth. There's a few little tips of the root coming. But basically, we're talking about bioassaying and seeing what kind of inhibition we can get. In general, we can get we can pretty much use a large number of different plant bacteria will, in high numbers, actually cause this inhibitory effect to any seed we want. But we're very careful at having low numbers of the bacterial counts on the plates. So either it does not inhibit the weed or it inhibits the weed. And then we make a decision and we take those that do not inhibit the weed and discard them into the autoclave. So we're left with 50% of what we started with. So then we bioassay on beneficial plants, the crop plants that we're interested in, the rangeland native plants, and a whole sphere of other plant species so that we make sure that we're getting just the inhibition of certain weeds that we want. So if it inhibits beneficial plants, we get rid of it. If it doesn't inhibit the beneficial plants, we keep it. So then we're talking about 1% of our population from the soil and the roots. And so we test those in the greenhouse, and you can see in the slide the control plant versus D7 and another isolate that was 3366. The D7's actually doing a pretty good job on downy brome in the greenhouse. So in the greenhouse, if it doesn't inhibit the weed or inhibits beneficial plants, we get rid of it. And if it inhibits the weed and not inhibit any beneficial plants, we keep it. So we're down a little bit more as far as numbers are concerned. Then we do field testing. If it doesn't inhibit in the field, or it inhibits beneficial plants, or it doesn't survive in the field, which is quite a big survival in the field is one of the biggest hurdles for a bacteria to actually get over in order to be a field control organism. But if it inhibits the weed and not beneficial plants, we keep it, and we have our biocontrol agent. But the whole idea of me going through this screening is it's not that we're pulling an organism off the shelf and saying, oh, we know that this is a pathogen to cheatgrass, so we're going to use it. No, we actually started saying, we know this phenomenon occurs, that there is this inhibition, and we know it's selective, so we're going to go out and screen a large, large number from the soils and select only those that inhibit weeds and not beneficial plants. So, here are the bacteria. You can see the cute little, in this picture, you have the bacteria. You can see it's a rod-shaped, gram-negative, has a really nice, thick polysaccharide coat, so it protects it during the cold weather and somewhat during the hot weather. And it's got these two cute little flagella. The flagella don't really help it do move or anything. It's just that they do have those flagella. So that's the bacteria that we actually are going to be talking about the most. But in general, these weed suppressive bacteria colonize the residue in the root. They survive well at low temperatures. They're not competitive at warm temperatures. They actually don't necessarily survive in high numbers when most of the soil microbes are the happiest. Okay, so as it from early to late spring, we'll see these bacteria kind of, their numbers decline because everybody else, the more competitive soil organisms kind of take over. So they're not trying to compete when there's this big rush to get into where there's moisture and warmth. They don't survive during the hot, dry summer. They go into a dormant phase, and I think that's their polysaccharide coats really help them there. They do produce plant suppressive compounds because we selected for those. And in general, we find that these organisms are members of the genus Pseudomonas. As far as the compounds are concerned, the reason that we don't know very much, or we haven't known very much about these types of organisms, is there really are no visible lesions produced when the organism is colonizing the root. These bacteria don't have any enzymes to actually get inside the root. So they don't break down the cell wall or the membrane and invade the root cells. What they do is they colonize on the surface of the root and into those areas of the root that are up to the Casparian strip. So they're outside the cell wall in most cases. But there are no visible lesions. There's no signs of pathogenicity as we had known it for the past couple all the years of studying plant pathology. But we do know that these organisms inhibit cell root elongation. They interrupt tiller initiation, which is crucial. They stunt the roots. They reduce the seedling vigor, and the seedling vigor is key to surviving over winter. So if you're a cheatgrass plant and you go into winter with just a little bit of this seedling vigor not there, you'll have a hard time surviving, and that's what we see. The colder the winter, the more the stress on the plants, the more the cheatgrass plants that have the bacteria on them are not able to survive over the winter. But if you do survive, the bacteria has initiated has interrupted the tiller initiation, and so we have this reduced tiller number, and we have a reduced number of seeds. Now, actually, the seed size is greater because there are less tillers, and so all those resources are going to those few number of seeds. So basically, what we have here is a very good match for biocontrol. We have these bacteria that produce a selective toxin at low temperatures that inhibits root growth, and it inhibits tiller initiation. We have a bacteria that reduces the competitiveness of the weed in fall and spring, and it allows other plants to be more competitive. So we have a very good match, and I think this is an important concept for people who are looking into biocontrol to make sure that the match is very good. We have a plant that is susceptible in the winter and early spring because it's growing, and we need to make sure, and if something inhibits that root growth, it can't get its competitive root growth going. And we have a bacterium that does a pretty good job of reducing the seed number, the tiller number, and the length of the roots. So we are going to be talking about one organism in particular. It's a Pseudomonas fluorescens, and the strain number is D7. Now, I know there's other product or there are other microbes out there that have lots neater names than D7, but this is actually an organism that was in row 7, column D that we worked with, and so that's how we name our organisms that we look at. So it's really easy in a bioassay to show inhibition, but really the crux is when you look at greenhouse studies with non-sterile soil, how well does the organism survive and how does it inhibit? What we found after looking at more than 200 different plant species is, first of all, D7 does not inhibit dicots at all, and it does not inhibit any of the grasses that are of economic or ecological value, okay? So we're only talking about, again, selecting for very few weeds that this organism or this bacterium would inhibit. In greenhouse studies, we found that PFD7 inhibited downy brome, California brome, mountain brome, jointed goatgrass, and Medusa head. That's all. We have not been able to find any other plant species that this organism inhibits. We have other organisms that inhibit other things, though, and we're working on those as well. So again, we selected for this phenotype very carefully, and we got down to knowing that only four plant species are inhibited. We use actually Wapshear's concentric method of looking at plant species we use. So we've looked at more of the bromes than anything else, and more of the grasses that are similar to the Bromus genus, and then went out from there and looking at different plant species. But we're very confident that there's a limited number of plant species that this organism will inhibit. Again, when you look at some of the literature on biocontrol, people sort of take an organism and say, well, it inhibits something, and you know, we can't find it inhibiting all these other species. But then if you don't do a very good analysis at this point, you will eventually find some plant species that, you know, one given organism might inhibit. We were working with the numbers and had high enough numbers that we could find very specific bacteria that inhibited only these plant species. Okay. So just a second about this Pseudomonas fluorescens strain D7 and its active compound. Again, an awfully cute little bacteria to work with. Its active compound actually is kind of probably the worst part about it. It's a chromopeptide with lots of different peptides associated with it, and fatty acid esters and polysaccharides all mixed in there. And we're talking about the partially purified toxin, because we can't seem to, with all that junk in there, we can't seem to get actually a purified product or purified toxin. We know it has tertiary structure because since we can't totally purify it, it's very labile and falls apart. So we figure that all these large compounds together form something that's very important there. But we know it reduces cell elongation, and we know that it reduces lipopolysaccharide production in the root, which then inhibits the root cell elongation. We know that the organisms that do produce a toxin, the genes responsible are chromosomal. They're not plasmid-borne, and they are multi-loci. So we have lots of different places on the chromosome that we are seeing this toxin be part of. So it's very difficult. It's not just going to one genetic area and saying, okay, this is where the toxin is produced. So because it's so many different compounds, it's difficult to study. But we wanted to look at survival to see, because you really don't want a microorganism that will survive too long and take over the community. So we needed to have some idea of how long this PFC7 survived in the soil and en route. What we have here is a graph of, on the x-axis, the log colony forming units per gram of soil, or the number of bacteria that are either in the red on soil, or the blue line is on the root. And what we find is, if we apply the organism, we apply it at fairly high rates to get established into the community, and we can, in the first year, we see a very nice population, a high population of the bacteria in the soil and on the roots. It's just in the early spring. In the next year, we see the bacteria kind of increasing in population in the spring, but not in necessarily high numbers, but they're there. And then in subsequent years, the organism dies off to below where we can detect the any level of the organism being there. So we see that the organism doesn't necessarily persist in the soil. We can't say for sure that it's not there, but as far as our means of looking at these bacteria, the organism survives for 2 or 3 years and then dies off with time. We have to use a RIF-marked strain since there's so many pseudomonads in the soil. So we're not, we use a PFD7 RIF organism to follow the survival in the soil. So we're hoping that we can get molecular probes to do a better job of looking at survival over time. What we know is that PFD7 likes cool temperatures. It likes to sit on the roots of the residue. It doesn't persist in high levels, which is good from an ecological standpoint for a product, and it eventually dies off. So how are we going to deliver it? Well, so we have two different means to deliver the organism into the field for biocontrol as a biocontrol agent. We can either spray it on, and we spray in such lousy weather. We have all sorts of different spray apparatus that protects any overspray or our wind problems. We can also put it on the seed, and what you see here is a diagram of a wheat plant that we have put the organism onto the seed of the wheat plant, planted it, and then diagram sort of what we think is happening as far as the movement of that bacteria on into the soil and into intersecting other roots from, say, downy brome. Or how does that organism spread when we put the organism on the seed? Well, once, if you're an organism and you're attached to the seed, you have a very nice ride down all the root area that you ever want, and any other root that you intersect, you're going to take advantage of all the exudates from those roots. So it is a very good delivery system. But we had to kind of prove, so we know that we can add D7 to the soil as a spray, and it survives quite well, or on the seed, crop seed or native plant seed. So we had to prove that there was actually colonization of the cheatgrass root when we applied the bacteria on this seed. And here what you have is a petri dish where we have a root impression, and no, it's not, we're not trying to sing Sinatra or anything like that. We're just looking at the root that we've pressed into some agar on a petri dish to see if our mark strain actually could be found on any downy brome root. And we really were able to find quite a nice colonization of the downy brome by the bacteria. So each of those little spots there that looks like a root is not the root, but actually the bacteria, the D7 bacteria that was on that root. And we were able to actually see inhibition of the cheatgrass with this method. So the application of this bacteria using seed is a pretty neat idea. So the D7 is carried down the wheat roots and intercepts and grows along the cheatgrass roots, and we get our inhibition. Okay, so you're just waiting for field studies. So let's talk a little bit about the field studies. Since we're crop-oriented, what you'll see first is our work on crop plants. We see here winter wheat planted with a no-till paired row drill into a natural infestation of cheatgrass. And this was done in Washington near Washtenaw. In the control plot to your left, you see the wheat plants that are bordering the sides of the slide. And then if you look in the inter-row, you can see quite a bit of cheatgrass in that inter-row. Where we inoculated or put the bacteria on, we were able to reduce the populations of cheatgrass by at least 50% in these fields. And so we were pretty pleased with that, those data. These are one of our first set of studies. So yes, in the field, we could actually inhibit cheatgrass by putting the bacteria on in the field with a natural infestation. So if we just look at some of our studies, here is a slide of the Washington studies in which we looked at winter wheat field trials. The D7 was applied in the fall as a spray. We always apply the D7 in the fall so it can actually establish itself as part of the community as it goes into winter, and then not necessarily have to compete with the more aggressive or bacteria that like to grow in the early spring and into the summer. and we take the counts in the fall. So what we have here on the y-axis is the reduction of downy barome or cheatgrass. This is we're talking about reduction of downy barome, so the as far as the bars are concerned, a larger bar means more inhibition. We had four different locations across Washington that ranged from on the left-hand side, we were talking about low precipitation zones to higher. And what we looked at was biomass in the red. Tiller number is blue, and the seed number is green. The asterisks actually indicate significant difference when we were looking at the control versus the bacteria applied. So it doesn't necessarily indicate anything about these data. It just shows that we actually did see significant difference across the plot area. What we're seeing is from about 35% reduction. Well, let's see. 30% reduction in biomass across the area. We saw reductions in the number of tillers. It depended on the location. And we looked at the seed number, and it was interesting at Washtenaw to see 60% difference, a reduction in the seeds produced at that site. What you're also seeing here, as you go across from left to right, where precipitation increased, and that was shown in our soil organic matter levels. So we were talking about 1% organic matter levels at Washtenaw and Ritzville, the drier sites, where actually we were seeing much better inhibition of the bacteria of the cheatgrass by the bacteria. And then we have this Dayton site, which is kind of interesting, where D7 just didn't survive. We couldn't pull it back out. Just for some reason, it did not work, and so we don't get any reduction in the cheatgrass. It's very important to realize that we're working with a live organism, and survival is the first thing that we need to make sure that we have. So D7 must survive and suppress downy barome. All right, so we were collaborating with some herbicide folks with this study, and they just weren't impressed with these numbers. Now, I look at a 50% reduction in cheatgrass, even a 40% reduction in cheatgrass by a bacterium, and I'm ecstatic. It's pretty exciting. And if we could, and we knew it didn't survive, so we didn't get the control, that's even better. But this is a one-year study, and they decided not to continue it on, so we abandoned these sites, which was kind of disappointing at the time, but we still could see that there's some inhibition. But I think there's a song, something about with different words, but if we only knew then what we know now, we would have kept on with that, because what happened is the grower collaborators came back and mentioned to me later that there was this patchwork of cheatgrass in the fields in which we had the bacterial plots out at there. And then they would see patches of heavy cheatgrass and then patches where there was no cheatgrass in the fields. But it took a couple of years. So what we learned from that, their observations, was that we needed to actually study these we needed to not act as if this organism was a herbicide, but rather look at it over a couple of years. And, you know, being a microbial ecologist, I should have thought about that at the time, but I did not. So we set up a whole bunch of different studies, and since this audience is more rangeland-oriented, I want to get into the rangeland studies that we've done. Here we have one at Saddle Mountain, in which there was a fire in July of 2000. And we applied the D7 and CDU with a rangeland mix in 2001. For A, you have the control where you see quite a bit of cheatgrass. Where we applied the bacteria in and these two pictures are taken in 2007, so quite a time after we had applied the bacteria. What we see is that we had a succession of turf pea come in, and then Russian thistle came in, and we also see now Indian rice grass establishing itself in these plots where we had applied the bacteria. Cheatgrass is still well established in the control plots, but where we put the bacteria, we can see that the plant species are moving in. Now, I look at this, and our group actually is in an air quality group, and so I see blow spots here. And, you know, nobody really likes Russian thistle, but it actually isn't it's not a bad successional plant somewhere in there. So we weren't really necessarily doing a good job. What these data show us was that, well, in fact, we could inhibit cheatgrass and something else would come in afterwards in the Battle Mountain area. And so we were pretty pleased with that. But we found out, well, we know that we need to have a better idea of how to actually get the native plants established. We also did another rangeland field trial in Rock Island, Washington, which is near Wenatchee. We actually put the D7 on the seed, Stamberg bluegrass seed. And here, we did this in 2005, just one application. And these photos are from 2008. And what we see is there's still cheatgrass in the control, and there's very little cheatgrass in the spots where we applied the bacteria. In fact, at this site, Stanberg bluegrass is actually taking over the site entirely now that we've got rid of the cheatgrass. We also have some money from the turfgrass, the Washington Turfgrass Seed Producers Commission. We put in some field trials at Colton, Washington, and these, again, the control, you can see the cheatgrass and the bacteria. Where we applied the bacteria, we were able to get rid of that cheatgrass, and then the turfgrass actually grew better without that cheatgrass as competition. We had some pasture field trials in Pullman, Washington, where we applied the D7. And again, the control, full of cheatgrass, bacteria, we're getting some really nice establishment of the bunch grasses. If we look actually at the data of the cheatgrass reduction with this D7 application over these four sites, what we have here on the x-axis is the cheatgrass plants in percent. Since the populations of cheatgrass varied across all those different sites, we had to put it at 100%. And we put these various field plots out at different times of different years. So we have one PF D7 application at time zero, and then we just used the years after application to show what the data looked like. And surprisingly, what we found is early on we have a little bit of inhibition of the cheatgrass by the bacteria, but with time, we're talking about 3, 4, 5 years, we can see that the cheatgrass populations in these three or four sites declined. There's some differences in how the actual numbers kind of fell out, and so we're interested in looking at that to see if there's differences in climate or plant competition that can give us some information about what's going on there. So over time, we were able to reduce the cheatgrass to near zero, and that is something that sometimes waiting is very, very hard for people to do. But I think what we're seeing here is that we have an ecological shift in the microbial population when we added this one organism that caused the organism to survive long enough to just work at the seed bank and get at that cheatgrass, reduce that seed number in the seed bank as time went on. So we have to be patient with this organism, not the herbicide paradigm that we've been working with. So then we put in a large study funded by the Nature Conservancy, working with the Northwest Ag Products group that's doing a lot of our scale-up work, the Fish and Wildlife Service, BLM, Bureau of Rec, and the EBIPM program out of Burns with Tony Sekar. up until now, we only knew that it worked in Washington and didn't bother looking at it further. But so in 2009, we put out many sites across Washington, Idaho, Oregon, California, Nevada, and Utah. We applied the C7 in the fall of 2009 as a sprayer on seed. And we applied in 2010 also as spray or on seed to another set of plots at the same location so we could see year-to-year variation. So we just sprayed it on the surface or we broadcast the seed, sort of the worst-case scenario, to see if it was going to work. We took plenty of counts of annuals, perennials, percent cover, heights, and we're continuing to do that. Here's just some pictures of what we saw. Yeah, this is cheatgrass from Elko. You can see where we applied D7 in the seed. We saw about a 40% reduction of cheatgrass. These are 2009 applied plots. Again, with 2009 in Aden, California, here's where we were working with medusa head. We saw about a 35% reduction in medusa head. And what I'm showing you here is the percent inhibition of D7, or percent inhibition of the cheatgrass or the medusa head with a D7 applied in 2010. And the counts were taken in 2011. So we're only talking about 1 year from spraying it on or putting it on the seed to counting. But here are all the plots that we were working with across the western United States. So each dot here indicates a location that we were working on. The organism was either put on as a spray or on native seed, in which we coated the seed with the D7. The size of the dots indicate the amount of inhibition we were seeing of the cheatgrass or medusa head by the D7. And so you can see that in some places, in Oregon and in Nevada, when we sprayed it on, we didn't really see that much of an inhibition for that year. And in Utah and California, we saw somewhere around a 40% inhibition. This is the first year, so it's what it's saying to us is that, yes, there actually is inhibition occurring at sites other than in Washington. We certainly got some of our best inhibition in Washington, as you can see. The seed, though, on the other hand, sometimes protected that organism better, and we were seeing some very nice initial inhibitions or suppression of the cheatgrass in those plots over that 1 year. So we're going to follow these studies further to see if with time, like in Washington, we can see the reduction further increase as time goes on. Now, ecologically speaking, you would think that an organism isolated from around Washington would do better in Washington than it would do in the other states. And so I wasn't necessarily expecting to see this amount of inhibition of the cheatgrass or the medusa head in the states outside of Washington. And so we're very pleased by these values or these levels of inhibition that we're seeing. But we're still trying to understand ecologically if taking organisms from the soils of these different states might even be a better deal for us. This is worst case scenario. We put these organisms out, sprayed them right before rain, and we seeded them on the surface, and yet still we were able to use the bacteria and cause a reduction in the weeds of choice, the cheatgrass or the medusa head, and still get some inhibition. Now, let me just tell you, in California and in Idaho and in Riverside, Oregon, which we don't have that didn't get sprayed in 2010, those are the three sites that we were looking at medusa head. The medusa head was suppressed just as well by PFD7 as cheatgrass had been in the field. So we're pretty pleased with those studies as well. So our major work is on cheatgrass, but medusa head seems to be inhibited just as much. Okay. So now the next, so we know that it inhibits the cheatgrass and medusa head in the field. Does a pretty good job even outside of Washington, so that's pretty neat. Well, what else? Does it inhibit anything else? So NAP, in the process of registering the this product or this biopesticide, has to do toxicology studies. And what they found is that D7 does not inhibit Daphnia, Lemna, doesn't hurt the bees at all. The fish were just fine. The birds are still singing. And the mice were okay, but they had some sniffles at the high dose. So overall, the toxicology studies are coming back quite nicely, and the organism doesn't inhibit. So scale-up involves large batches of these, brewing these organisms. And no, this is not a brewery. These are actually fermenters that the bacteria grow in. You're talking about thousands and thousands of product that can be produced. And there's an awful lot of engineering that goes into making sure that the brew is the right at the right temperature and pH for the best product. Scale-up involves freeze-drying, so NAP has freeze-dryers. The freeze-dried bacteria looks sort of like crumbled styrofoam. And when they pack it, they package it in vacuum-packed bags, sort of like that ice cream, that astronaut ice cream you get in those freeze-packed bags. So anybody who's had any freeze-dried food on a camping trip kind of knows what this product will sort of look like. It's very powdery and doesn't look like anything at all. Okay, so other facts that are probably floating around your head, and I'm actually running out of time here. So what's the application rate? Well, we need about a pint of active ingredient put down in the fall. Can we tanks mix with herbicides? Yes, the bacteria doesn't seem to be inhibited by most of the herbicides that we would be using. Does it impact soil ecology? Well, we try really hard to not have it impact the soil ecology on and take over all the niches that might be in the soil. It's not very competitive, and it's at a specific time period that we apply the organism in a time period that it survives, and then it does not persist. So we're not thinking that it's really a huge, big impact to soil ecology. Now, the fact that we're taking away that substrate or that food of the cheatgrass or the medusa head residue is kind of a factor, but as far as applying the bacteria, we think it's pretty ecologically benign. Can resistant plants develop? Well, anytime you stress anything, yes, of course, resistant plants can develop, but it would be much more slowly, and we have lots of different organisms in the wing. Will it change to hurt crops? Will there be some jumping around of the genes? Because it's multi-loci, we don't think that there, it's just not going to be really hard to take all those genes and get them into a crop plant so that, or get it so that it inhibits a crop plant. You know, so it's probably not going to be changed much so that this host will change to a crop plant. Cost, what's it going to cost? Is it going to be exorbitant? Well, this will be set by the company, Northwest Ag Products, and probably it will be equal to something like glyphosate. Why is the toxin produced? Well, that's a great question, and we would love to know. It's a secondary metabolite. We don't really know what the whys or wherefore, but that's okay. We're going to use it. Okay, so the things that I want you to remember, first of all, soil is alive, and it's full of genetic potential. The bacteria that we have found inhibit specific plant species, and we screen for specific plant species. Bacteria can be used to suppress weeds. And we have a good biocontrol match, okay? So we're not here for biocontrol's sake necessarily, but we have a good match, and that's what's most important with biocontrol agents now. We have to make sure that they really match the host that we're trying to get rid of. With weed reduction, we see that plant diversity can increase, so we can change things, and that in the whole realm of things, really, we can use microbes to shift plant succession in a managed arena. But the dynamic soil interactions are very, very complex, and so there's lots of things that we don't know. So our future work that we are hoping to do, if we can get funding, is to develop strategies that increase the survival of D7 and increase its efficacy or its ability to inhibit the weeds. We want to improve our cheatgrass and medusa head reduction in the field and increase native species establishment. So I know that I can kill the the cheatgrass and the medusa head. I just don't know a good way to establish the native species. Not that any of the native species are inhibited by the D7, but we need help on that. We need to work on bacterial survival studies and formulations to get the organism to be more viable in the field. We'd like to work throughout the West. We still think that the seed and the spray are two good treatments, but I think we need to work on seeding of native species. And we have nothing. We think that adding a herbicide to the mix or many herbicides to the mix will actually help us in getting rid of these two weeds. We're thinking about minimal disturbance because we do know that the soil is best when there's less tillage or disturbance. And we also like to try to isolate bacteria from each of the areas to see if we can find a regional D7 that inhibits better than the Washington D7. Oh, I forgot. I got so excited about what I was thinking about doing, I forgot to go through those. Sorry about that. So those are all the things that we want to do in the future work. There's lots of things still to go on. Money, of course, seems to be at the all-time low, but we have lots of possibilities there. One last thing to remember, that the role of the infinitely small in nature is infinitely great. I think Louis Pasteur said it so well, that we have this opportunity to look at the soils for something that ecologically we have a hard time with, and hopefully we can use these bacteria to rebalance the ecology of rangeland and cropland. And with that, I am done, and I would be glad to entertain those questions. Susanna?
Thanks so much, Anne. We actually have quite a few questions, so we're going to work our way down the list. The first we have is from Kelly Fisher. She asks, what does bioassay mean?
Oh, a bioassay?
Yes.
So we can't necessarily take these 10,000 isolates and go out in the field right away. So we have to actually do some trial studies. And so our bioassays were to use water auger and apply the bacteria to the surface of the water auger and plant the weed seeds into that, into either a control with no bacteria or a bacteria plates, and let them grow to see what would happen. And so we were able to identify those bacterial species that we wanted to keep on working with if they inhibited the cheatgrass or the medusa head.
Great. The next one is from Sean Finn. Sean asked a question on PFD7 survival in soil. Was that a field trial, and was that in agricultural soils or a natural setting?
The survival studies that we did with the data that I put up there, where we looked across many years, was in a pasture, and we studied it over 5 years to see if we could identify the persistence of that organism. So it was in the field. It wasn't in a agricultural field. It was in a pasture.
Great. Sean also comments that understanding the relationship among precipitation zone and effectiveness is a key piece of information.
Of course, yes. So it's not only precipitation, but it's actually the soil biology. And so the D7 tour data that we have collected, we have a whole slew of weather data that's attached to each of those field sites. And we have microbial community studies and soil analyses from all those different sites. So in the next year, we're going to be looking at using multivariate analysis to try to hone out, pull out what we can find from all those sites across the West. So yes, we're working on that.
Thank you. Kelly Fisher asks, what state was the Saddle Mountain fire in 2000?
Oh, Washington.
Okay.
It was by Mattawa, Washington.
Okay. And she also asks, are there other bacteria that may inhibit other invasives such as Russian thistle, leafy spurge, or others?
So, yes, there are. And there are other people working on some of these, the other weed species. Our group specifically looks at grass weeds. And so we have organisms that inhibit bentonata grass and Italian ryegrass and other grass species that are problematic. Other people are looking at, what was it, leafy spurge, and I'm not sure about Russian thistle, but there are other folks that are working more with the dicots, and I'm just sticking more with the grasses. So, but yes, there's no doubt that we can find other organisms in the soil. Now, one of the things I didn't mention was that we really aren't interested in just one organism necessarily, but we'd rather manage for weed suppressiveness. And so we're trying to understand weed suppressive soils and what kind of community will be making up a microbial community that could be inhibitory to these different weeds. Okay, Susanna.
Great. The next question is from Larry Zuckerman, and he asked, what seed bank is continually renewed by grazing domestic livestock moved on to areas with the bacteria treatment? What do you predict, or could you treat livestock with the bacteria?
The flag that comes up in my mind is regulatory work, and we do actually have a grazing study in one of the sites that we work at. And actually, the interesting thing about grazing is there could be the hoof movement in the soil actually can help get the organism further into the soil. So, I'm not sure exactly how to answer that question, but what I'll say is that there are many different ways that we can get the organism into the soil. I doubt that anybody would let us, the regulatory-wise, put it on cattle hooves to get in there, but the grazing part of it isn't necessarily a positive or negative. It's just it could be part of the management scheme that someone might want, so it is a possibility.
Next is from Ken Henke. He asks, curious why the cheatgrass numbers were significantly reduced years later after application when the number of PFD7 is significantly reduced over that same time period.
Ooh, that's a great question. Yes. So here's the deal. So I don't really know, but you're right. So we see this gradual decrease in the cheatgrass numbers, and the populations aren't necessarily very high. That we can actually identify or count. So maybe the D7 numbers don't need to be high in order to, they don't need to be as high as we think they need to be in order to work at the seed bank. I think that the natural decline is due to the fact that we are working, or the organisms are working, every year to get to reduce that seed bank, and there are other plant species that are coming in and being more competitive. They help at reducing that cheatgrass load, and so it's not just a correlation between the D7 bacteria, but that what the D7 starts in changing the plant ecology and of that area. So if you reduce the seed bank a little bit, people are saying, well, no, I mean, D7 can grow anywhere, but we're stunting that growth enough that there could be introduction of the native or the seeded plant species, and that's helping with that, to further reduce that, the cheatgrass numbers. I don't really know, but it is interesting, yes.
Okay, Ken has a few other questions. Was there much, if any, aerial application on rangeland?
Well, we haven't done that. We have not done aerial application, but we are certainly wanting to use that as a method of application. And as soon as the product becomes registered, you know, that will be, that's part of the registration. It is a very, very viable possibility. I think we need to work on formulations before we do the aerial application, though, because I think we need to, you know, we can't just throw out the freeze-dried material into the air necessarily, but I just don't know if it would survive or not, but we're hoping for aerial applications. Okay, Susanna?
Did you conduct any tank mix with imazapic?
Yes, we did, and not necessarily on the field, but for survival purposes, and the organism does survive, and so we know both, you know, we know that we can actually do tank mixes in the field. We have not done the field trials yet, but that's something that we need to do.
And lastly, from Ken, do you have a timeline for commercial availability?
Well, I have a timeline for commercial availability, and then NAP has a timeline for commercial availability. So they're going through the registration process right now, and so I keep on saying next fall, next fall, next fall, but they're thinking probably 2 years out from all that they have to do with the getting this whole thing registered and commercialized and everything and out the door. They already have a couple products that are microbial products that they market right now, and so they're pretty skilled at doing this. So I'm assuming I'm just, my next fall is too early, and their 2 years is probably a better estimate.
Okay. David Overcast asks, who were you working with in Elko, Nevada?
Well, we're with the, those were the sites at the EBIPM. So Kent McAdoo was the major contact. I don't really know what the landowner's name was. But I can get you that information if you want to email me, and you can see my email right there on the screen. Okay, Susanna?
John Simmons asks, for all the trial plots, was the source of the PFD7 from Washington? Is PFD7 found in the soils in other states?
Well, we don't really know. We can't tell whether the there is PFD7 in other states unless we go through the screening process that we go through. What we're trying to do is develop a molecular probe so that we can actually look at soils of from anywhere to see what the levels of this organism might be. But right this second, we can't, because it's a Pseudomonas, and there are billions of Pseudomonas in the soil, so we can't really differentiate unless we have the toxin genes on a probe. So I don't know.
Okay. Pamela Schwind asks, does it work the same on goat grass? We farm winter wheat and have a problem with goat grass.
Yes, interestingly enough, up here in Pullman, jointed goatgrass is a real problem and is growing in numbers. And we do have some field trials, some field trial data, and it does a very nice job on reducing the jointed goatgrass just the same way. So initially, we'll get a 30 to 40% reduction in jointed goatgrass numbers, and then over time, we see it slowly decline. Now, depending on the amount of cultivation in a cropland area, we will see some of that, those organisms, or some of the applied organisms die off a little bit faster. But yes, jointed goatgrass is just as nicely inhibited.
Great. Kelly Fisher asks, have you tested this bacteria on shrubs such as sage to see the effect?
There's no inhibitory effect or no stimulatory effect. It just doesn't have any
any effect at all on the growth. Now, I'll tell you, the organism, D7, produces an antifungal compound also in addition to this cheatgrass inhibitory compound. And when we apply it to wheat seed, a lot of times that antifungal activity will show wheat actually having greater yields than when the organism isn't on the seed. So, but for most, it's only wheat that we see the stimulation and no other plant species.
Okay. Next, Robert Burton asks, have you looked at effects of imazapic specifically on PFD7 establishment, effectiveness, and first-year survival?
Right now, all that we've done with the imazapic is done small studies, knowing that the organism does survive with the imazapic, and then we've done field studies where we've applied imazapic as the supposedly the non-weedy control, but doesn't necessarily always work that way. But so imazapic in the first year does a pretty good job of getting rid of the everything, pretty much, even though it's not supposed to. But then the weeds come back in the second year. So if we put imazapic in the D7 together, it'd be interesting to really see if we could get that, even to do better reduction over years with the dual combination. Yeah, it's a good idea. But no, we haven't done any of those studies.
Okay. Robert also asks, how can funded groups solicit rangeland tests on Medusa head cheatgrass in Nevada?
Our big thing is that we don't have the money necessarily to go out and try. So if we could get some funding to work on replicated field plots, large field plots is what we're actually, acres in size now, we could possibly do some things, but it's hard for us with the limited budget we have to do any collaborations, but we could talk about it.
Okay. Steve Beckenham asks, what is the largest application that has ever been performed in a range setting?
Oh, we are actually talking about small field plots because we are limited by EPA and the 10-acre rule. So we're talking probably half-acre plots or the this is probably the biggest area that we've looked at, and we always replicate, so the actual plot size would be smaller than that. So, but yeah, we have not yet done the large acreage applications that we would like to do.
Okay. I'm going to go ahead and ask that we close down any new questions. We still have a lot to go through, so I'm going to ask that we don't have any new questions come in, and if you do have questions that don't get answered in the remainder of the webinar, you go ahead and email Ann. Let's go ahead and work through what we have, though. Brandon Napton asks, can you elaborate on keeping the organisms viable during or prior to application?
Oh, that's another great question. So here's the idea there is that we're talking about a live organism, and so again, the thinking has to change a little bit for when you talk about these agromicrobials, in that the organisms are freeze-dried and they're vacuum-packed, so they're pretty stable right there, but they still need to be kept cold. And so to market something like this, and we have seen this now coming available in more of our ag chem supply places, that it would have to be kept frozen and then used immediately after opening, so that you put it into the tank and mix it up and shake it, make sure it's well distributed, and then spray it right out. And so it's not something that can sit on the dashboard of a pickup or anything like that and experience any high temperatures in order to keep it viable. So it's a little bit more to manage than a herbicide, but I think it's worth it considering what we can do with the end result. So.
Okay. Jennifer Wilson just asked one word, Vintanata, with a question mark.
Yes. Yes, we have some isolates that look promising for Vintanata grass. It's not D7. It's another one of the organisms that we initially isolated when we first started this. So we're excited about that. But first, we have to get the large scale plots out for the cheatgrass, and once we get, the cheatgrass is our first priority, but then we have some of these in line that inhibit some of the other grasses.
Okay. Grant Frost asks, were any of the trials done in native rangelands or shrub dominated areas?
Yes. Let's see. So in all of the sites outside of Washington were in native rangeland associated with the EBIPM. And there were shrubs in many of them. A lot of times what we would do, depending on the site, is we would, at each site, each location, we would select a site that was a monoculture, cheatgrass or medusa head, and then we would use a mixed culture, mixed site that had shrubs as well. So yes, we have that data. I didn't differentiate at this point just because we still have to kind of look through the data, but it does have application in a monoculture as well as in a mixed shrub step type of native stand.
Grant also asked, does elevation have any effect on PF D7?
Well, again, so I think eventually when we get all the data in from the D7 tour sites, where all those sites are with the different elevations, we will see, be able to tell you that. Right this second, I don't know. So you'll have to wait for the manuscript, I guess.
And Grant's last question is, does the bacteria spread through the soil or does it stay in one place?
So normally soil bacteria don't really travel much. So even with those flagella that the D7 has, it pretty much stays put. The plot areas would, the bacteria might extend across a plot area with time if it persisted. The only way, though, that the bacteria will move is if there's erosion and it attaches to a soil particle and moves off-site that way. So it's not like fungi, where fungi can, you know, travel for several feet and reestablish. For bacteria, once you're established there, you're pretty much there forever. So it's either tillage or erosion or movement by water or air that would move those organisms. And other than that, nope, it's not going to move very much.
Charles Kelly asked, do you have studies of bacteria in reduction of Canadian thistle and other thistles?
Again, sort of like the other one, we work with the grasses, and I know that there's some bacteria, I think from Minnesota, that was looking at thistles, but I don't work with that plant species.
And I apologize if I'm repeating some of these questions. We've had so many good ones. If they're similar, but the next question is from Stan Dykes. When could trials be done, for instance, in New Mexico? So I think he's asking when it's commercially available. And I think that goes along with asking the commercial availability.
Yeah, I think we're talking two years, if not more, about those kinds of things. Research-wise, I'll tell you, from a research standpoint, right now we have the 10-acre rule this coming fall, so we're limiting our numbers of plots that we put out. But once we get the experimental use permit and the registration, then then we can actually put out more acreage, and then that will kind of free up the research side. But for, as far as the marketing standpoint, getting product out to people, it will be probably 2 years, if not three.
Okay. And he was also curious if we would like to facilitate a trial plot in our state or locale, you know, how would he go about doing that?
Well, again, my email, so for all those kinds of questions, my email's at the bottom. And if you want to contact me, we can talk more.
Okay. His last question is, once an area is treated, does the treatment site ever grow in size as the organism multiplies?
Again, the bacteria pretty much stay in their place, and so we don't have a good idea of when a next application would need to occur. We just don't have that figured out. And we really don't necessarily do dual applications. So those are things that I don't exactly know at this point.
Okay. Dan Blake asked, did you take edge effect into account when you saw the other invasives in your plots? Were they present in the surrounding range?
Yes, of course.
Okay. And he also asked, did you sow native seeds into the experimental plots to offset other invasions?
Well, I think we didn't do a good job of seeding the natives because we just spread it on the surface. The actual reason for a lot of our seeding is to as a carrier for the bacteria rather than to get anything else growing. And so I think this next set of studies that we do, we really need to work at establishing. Getting those natives to actually grow, and I think we need to do seeding with a grain drill or something